In the fall of 1984, I got on an airplane and I flew for the first time in my life on an airplane. Flew to San Diego, not to go surfing, but for Marine Corps boot camp. And that was a unique and interesting experience. Full of busy days, full of activity, full of screaming and yelling, and sometimes a lot of sweating and sometimes crying. We had a very regimented routine every day. We got up at the same time, we ate at the same time, we did certain exercises at the same time. One thing that we looked forward to every single day was personal time. At the end of the day, the drill instructor would come out of his office and he would stand at the front of the squad bay and call all the recruits up front, and we would sit down cross-legged in formation, of course. It's the Marine Corps, right? We would sit in formation and he would start to call out names. Private Smith, Private Jones. And when you heard your name, you would jump up, run to the front of the squad bay, sound off your name. He just said it. I had never figured that one out. He would hand you your mail from the stack of letters that he had. And you would then take your letter back and sit down. And when all the mail had been dispersed, you had 1 hour of private time. In that time, we washed our uniforms by hand with a scrub brush. Big excitement. We polished our boots. We studied things that we had to learn. And we read our letters from home. That was wonderful. That was a source of anticipation every day. You can imagine something similar in 62 AD. Word starts to go around. There's a letter from Peter. Peter wrote us a letter. We have a letter to read. There's going to be a letter. Let's all get together. Because that's how the family did it. They all got together and somebody would read the letter from Peter, or they would read the letter from Paul or whoever it was. This letter was from Peter. It was written around 62 AD, most likely from Rome. We can say with pretty good accuracy it was in the early part of 62 AD. In 62 AD, Rome burned. The city of Rome caught fire and burned for 19 days. They didn't have fire departments. A lot of people say, well, Nero burned Rome. Actually, Nero didn't burn Rome. Nero was about 30 miles away when the city caught fire. A few days later, he was in no hurry. He came back to Rome, but it continued to burn. Finally, the fires got under control. And then 2 days later, the fire sparked back up and it burned for 3 more days. Well over half the city of Rome was destroyed. We have no record, no official record, that Nero actually said the Christians did it. But we do know that he didn't do anything to stop the rumors. Peter's letter was written because the Christian church was starting to struggle a little bit in a lot of ways. He wrote the letter to area of cities in Asia Minor. I think I have a map up there. Yeah. If you look up here, you see where Rome is on the left. On the right, we see this area where these churches are at that Peter was writing to. That's modern-day Turkey. It used to be called Asia Minor. Most of that is in modern-day Turkey. You notice in there that is Galatia. Well, about 15 years earlier, Paul had written a barn burner of a letter to the Galatians, and we have that letter in the Bible. If you remember the letter to Galatians, he gives his credentials, as they commonly did. He said, this is who I am. And then he just lit into him. What are you people doing? What is going on? So there may have been a little bit of apprehension in the Galatian church anyways. Oh my gosh, is Peter going to light into us now? The letter of 1 Peter is very applicable for us today for a lot of reasons. We too are not officially, governmentally persecuted. It's not like the Christian church would experience a few short years later under the rule of Domitian and Trajan and some of these people, some of these Roman leaders who literally hunted Christians down and killed them. This wasn't happening yet. It was on the horizon, but it wasn't happening yet. We see the same thing in our culture today. It can be hard to get a job. It can be hard to be treated equally in the business realm. If you're a believer, if people know you're a Christian, if you really live the life, you can be harassed legally, you can be pestered and badgered. If you speak up for your faith, you can be shouted down. People have no respect. And that's difficult. It wears on us. And we'll talk about that. We're going to take a mid-level flyover, so to say, of the book of 1 Peter. It's not going to be 50,000 feet in Mach 5. It's going to be more like 20,000 feet in Mach 2. I looked at, as Pastor Joshua and I were breaking this series and breaking this book up, how we're going to preach it, I looked at a number of different other pastors who have preached this, notable, reputable pastors who have preached it, and the average was about 25 to 30 sermons to get through 1 Peter. We're going to do it in 9. So it's going to move a little quicker. We're going to take a little bit bigger chunks. And the reality is that there's going to be some stuff left on the table, so to say. We're not able, with some other things that we have going on, to get that deep into it. In your bulletin is a schedule of the sermon series. It lists out the passages we're going to be looking at and who's going to be preaching them. So I guess if you want to use that to judge skipping a Sunday, you can. But the reason that's in there is so that during the week prior to a passage being preached, you can read through this. I would encourage you, once or twice a week, read the entire book of 1 Peter. It's 105 verses. It's about a 20-minute read. Read through the passage that's going to be preached the upcoming Sunday every day. We're averaging about, 15 verses or so. What's that? Another 5 minutes of reading? Read on it, think on it. In addition to your own devotional and Bible study reading, take a few minutes and engage with the text so that the time that we spend together becomes cooperative. We can learn and walk through this together. We can use the time to our advantage. The other thing that I would ask is that you sincerely keep myself and Joshua in prayer as we prepare these sermons. When we're moving through the text like this, if we're doing a 1 week flyover of Peter, it's almost easier. If we're digging in deep, it's almost easier. But we really, really desire the illumination of the Holy Spirit on the text to know what God has for his people. I would pray, I would ask earnestly for your earnest prayer to guide us as we go through this. The book of Peter, or this section that we're going through today, basically breaks down it naturally breaks down into this classic stereotypical evangelical sermon. 3 points in a prayer, right? That's like the gold standard. The first section, the first couple of verses, is Peter's greeting. It's his credentials, and he begins to lay the foundation of who he is, what he believes, and what he's bringing. The second section we're going to look at, verses 3 through 12, he speaks of hope, inheritance, and trials. And the last section, the last three verses, he says, be holy. Be holy. With that, I ask you to open your Bibles to the first letter of Peter, page 1282, at least in my Bible, and that's the one that counts, right? Beginning in verse 1, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside as strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who are chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood. May grace and peace be multiplied to you. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold, which perishes though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls. As to this salvation, the prophets who prophesied of the grace that would come to you made careful searches and inquiries, seeking to know what person or time the Spirit of Christ within them was indicating as he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories to follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you in these things, which now have been announced to you through those who preach the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Keep sober in spirit. Set your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance, but like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves in all your behavior, because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. Father God, I pray that you would bless the reading of your word, imprint it on our hearts, burn it into our minds, that we would walk in the light of your way and your will in all things. Amen. First Peter starts in verse 1, or Peter starts in first chapter in verse 1, giving his credentials. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, and we kind of run over that sometimes, but that's an important point for Peter. An apostle, as used in the Bible, was someone who had seen Jesus, had been called by Jesus, and was serving him. So it was not just this random, you couldn't just randomly slap that title on. If you did, you're going to get, at best, laughed out of the church. But it sets a seriousness to what he's saying here. It sets an authority that people would listen to. He also sets out who he's talking to. He's addressing his audience, Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, all these. And in his audience, understand, Peter was writing to churches that probably had been transplanted or planted from Jerusalem. They were started by Jews, but were primarily Greeks. So there's this kind of mixed culture thing going on there. There was multiple cultures. There was multiple ethnicities. There was mixed geographies. In those, you know, we think now, oh, I'm going to drive into town. It's 10 miles. It's not a big deal. Oftentimes in these days, people never went more than 3 or 4 miles from where they were born. They would never travel that far. It was virtually another planet. So that would cause cultures to grow independently and become different. And it's this very mixed bag that Peter's talking to. However, looking at the end of verse 1 into verse 2, all believers are foreknown, chosen, elected by God. He called us personally, called us. All believers have been cleansed by Jesus' blood, and we're all being sanctified by the Spirit. And these unifiers are far greater than any differences, cultural differences, ethnic differences, any sort of preferential differences. The cars we drive, the music we listen to, the turns of phrase, the speech that we use. And this is an important characteristic, and it turns up multiple times in Scripture. Take a look at, you don't have to turn there, but if you're taking notes and to check it out later, Colossians 3:11, the entire chapter of Ephesians 2 goes over this. Peter then moves on to give his big idea, his proposition, his thesis statement, if you will, the main launching pad that he's going to be speaking from for the rest of his letter. And this goes through verses, starts in verse 3, goes through verse 12, and these break down into these little pairs, these little repeated motifs over and over again. It's interesting to look at differences in different books of the Bible. A lot of Paul's letters, for instance, Romans, Ephesians that I mentioned, are very linear. Point A to point B to point C, if this, then that, that sort of thing. Very deeply influenced by the Greek thinkers in that culture that had been around a couple of hundred years before and had formed how people formally thought. We'll get to that in a little bit. Peter's not so much. Peter's letter kind of reflects what we see of Peter's personality. Kind of a hothead, kind of jumps around. You know, this is the guy that one moment he's talking to Jesus, and Jesus says, on the rock of that truth you just said, the church will be built. And then a few minutes later, get thee behind me, Satan. That's Peter. That's Peter in a nutshell. He's passionate. He believes strongly. He's heavily involved and heavily invested. And so we see that as he's writing. He'll say something, he'll make a point, or he'll give an idea, and then here's how we apply it. And then here's another idea, and this is how we use it. And we're going to see that in this section here. This pattern's repeated twice in the passage, verses 3 through 5, and then he donuts it around or loops back to it in 6 and 9. Then again, verses 10 through 12 and 13 through 16. He sets up oftentimes a theological basis for what he's saying, sets the foundational truth of what he's saying. Starting in the verse 3 through 5 section, praise to God the Father and Jesus Christ, who showed mercy and saved us. And it's easy to let that slide, to think that, yeah, I know that. But again, think about this. He did this for us. The Father sent his son Jesus. He showed mercy, and he showed grace, and he saved us. Did not give us what we deserved. Gave us what we don't deserve. And he saved us. He did this. He began it. He completes it. In verses 4 through 5, he describes some of the attributes of our salvation. An inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, will not fade away, preserved in heaven for you who are protected by the power of God. That's praiseworthy. That is certainly, certainly praiseworthy. In verses 6 through 9, he begins to speak of application. In this you greatly rejoice. We don't just start rejoicing over something for no apparent reason. We just don't do it. Maybe our kid finally got a good grade. Oh wait, that was me when I was a kid, sorry. Maybe our team won. Maybe, you know, who knows? Who knows what it is? Maybe the car started. I'm sure Joshua and Karen will be praising when they land safely in Israel. There's a reason for it. It's an indicative reasoning rather than imperative. Indicative being, we see this and that means something. What we see means something. God has saved us and therefore. It's not a command, it's a natural follow through. If we've been saved, how can we not praise? Starting in 6 and 7, we then see another one of these donuts in that you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been distressed by various trials. When he says for a little while, what that meant, the way it would have been understood in that day in 62 AD would have been in the little bit of time that you are on this earth. In the little bit of time you're on this earth compared to eternity. Not, you know, it's, again, it can be so easy for us to focus on temporal, just the temporal. For a little time, oh, this persecution, this trial, this issue, this whatever, it'll be over in, you know, a few hours or a few days. Maybe not. But in light of eternity, it's nothing. Nothing. It's all times, all things, whatever it is that we may be perceiving as suffering, whenever that happens and for however long it happens. He mentions being distressed by various trials. Understand. When he's talking about trials, he's talking about something different than what would have been translated tribulations, okay? Peter's talking about stuff that if we look back, it can be easy to say, well, why were they getting upset? They really didn't need to be upset about not being able to buy something in the market. They didn't need to be that upset about not being able to work. A craftsman maybe not being able to sell his wares to feed his family. Come on. That's just a temporal thing. But when it's our lives, it can get heavy. The Geneva Bible, the first widely available English translation, predates the King James by 50 or 75 years, translates that as, you are in heaviness. You are in heaviness. Have we felt that way? Have we felt like we're in heaviness? Does maybe when we look out at the culture around us, we feel like we're in heaviness? How can Peter talk about this, talk about these trials, this heaviness, as if it's a for sure thing, as if it's inevitable, like the sunrise? Well, the reality is that the world hates God. And therefore, the world hates God's people. The world hates us. That's not to be taken as a, well, we need to circle the wagons and expect the worst all the time. It's a simple reality that we live in. The simple reality that we live in. As a result of that, we're going to experience trials. We would be foolish to not know that, to not understand that, to not believe that. And there's plenty of teachers and preachers out there who are more than happy to sell us a bill of goods and say, oh, do this and everything will be okay. Somewhere in that list is usually send me money, but not always. But we know this. John chapter 15, Jesus is talking to his disciples. Know that if the world hates me, the world's going to hate you. And if the world hates you, it's because the world hates me. We see that in first chapter of Romans. Paul talks about that. But then Peter moves on. Speaking of our faith that is more precious than gold. More precious than gold in verse 7. And it can be easy for us to often misplace our values or our sense of value. It's almost a cliche for a preacher to talk about placing too much value on jobs or homes or cars or status or families or possessions or knowledge or any of these things. But oftentimes cliches become a cliche for a reason. It happens to us. It can happen to us. We can slowly, if we're not careful, lose our perspective. Our perspective kind of shifts. Or we can value insignificant things so much that we distort or even obscure important things. In the late 1800s, early 1900s, the De Beers family heard of a huge find of diamonds in South Africa. So they looked into it, and lo and behold, somebody had found a rich treasure trove of diamonds. And so the De Beers family bought the entire mine complex and then just sat on it. Because prior to that, we had assumed that diamonds were valuable, that they were valuable because they're rare. Turns out diamonds aren't really all that rare. There's gobs and gobs and gobs of them. The prices for diamonds are only the way they are because A, people are willing to pay for it. B, we have this perception that they're super rare. Many, many, many types of gemstones are far more rare than diamonds. And interestingly enough, we often see those gemstones mentioned in the Bible. Diamonds, not so much. For instance, a ruby. A ruby starts, all else being equal, at roughly twice the value of a diamond. And the bigger the ruby gets, and the bigger the diamond gets, the greater the difference is, the more the ruby is worth. Our view can be distorted by the world around us. The true value of something is shown, though, when it's under stress. In the second half of verse 7, though tested by fire, it may be your faith may be found to result in praise, glory, and honor, the revelation of Jesus Christ. As our faith is tested, we see that it holds. We see that it holds. The world doesn't have that. The world doesn't have that. Famous poem, "The center does not hold." At the end of verse 7 through verse 9, we see here the progression of the faithfulness of Jesus. May be found to result in praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus. And though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls. Why is this so important? Why is testing, why are trials so important? Because faith leads to trust. Trust enables us to be tested. And when that faith and that trust is shown to be true, it raises, and it happens again and again and again. It's like lifting weights. You probably can't tell. I enjoy lifting weights. Why is a whole other deal, I guess. But you don't, why do people lift weights? People lift weights to get strong. Ultimately, you lift weights to get strong. If you lift the same weight over and over and over, how much stronger do you get? You don't. In fact, your strength will decrease. But as the weight goes up, as you put more plates on the bar and you pull heavy, you pull hard, you get stronger so that you can lift more. You become more useful in your life, just in your normal life. There's a tremendous amount of health benefits from any form of exercise where we push ourselves, where we're tested, where we go through a trial and then succeed. Same thing with our faith. And we will do that again and again and again until that day, until the day where we see our Father, where we see our Lord and Savior. That cycle will continue. Verses 10 through 12 speaks of the longing and the desire across time for a relationship that we now have with God. This is the same hope we have today with regard to the certainty of God's promises. There's a lot in that, and this is one of those spots that we just don't have time to dig deeply into. Speaking of the prophets and things that angels desire to look and long to look into. But this is an example of biblical theology. You've heard me talk about, when I've been here to preach before, speaking of systematic theology. Systematic theology is where we take a concept, say justification, and we start in Genesis 1:1, and we go through the entire Bible to the end of Revelation, and we find all the references to justification, and we gather all that up, and we go through it, and we look at it. What does it mean? How does it happen? What's the result of it? All these sorts of questions, right? That's systematic theology. That's how we get the building blocks of our doctrine and our faith. It's important. It's a lot of work, but it's important. This, however, demonstrates biblical theology. This is not about us. This is about God. This is His story. Now, we get to play a part in that story, and that is fabulous. But it's His story. And biblical theology is where we see how all the strands, all the threads, all those stories and incidences, all the letters, all the narratives get woven together into this incredible tapestry. It shows us our Father. This demonstrates how the gospel is woven throughout Scripture, throughout that story. It's shown in foretelling, it's shown in revealing, it's shown in displaying, and it's shown in declaring at different places and different times in Scripture. And for this, we give thanks. We give thanks for this salvation. When we look at it systematically, when we look at it biblically, we gain an understanding. And for that, we give thanks. The first Sunday of every month, most months, we celebrate communion. And communion means a lot of things. There's a lot of reasons, a lot of aspects to communion. It can be a time of repentance. Paul speaks of that. If there's something in your heart that you need, if you need to do business with God before you come to his table. If you need to do business with your brother or your sister, do business with your brother or sister before you come to the table. It can be a time of repentance. It can be a time of healing. It can be a time of understanding. But today, I want to use this opportunity for communion as a time of thanksgiving. A time to take a moment in the model that our Lord gave us to thank him for who he is and what he's done for us and the things that we've talked about so far.
Turning back to our text.
We come to the so what. What is all this that Peter's talked about mean? What is this, an intellectual exercise? Is it just an interesting story? A random letter that we just happen to have a copy of 2,000 years later? We get to verse 13. One of my favorite words in the Bible. Therefore, you've heard Joshua say it, I've said it, probably everybody who's ever preached a sermon more than once or twice has said, when you see therefore, you have to ask yourself, what is therefore there for? What purpose does it serve? It's a fulcrum. It's a dividing point. It's a point of difference. These truths that Peter has talked about, these truths demand certain responses. The magnitude of what Peter is talking about is so great that we don't get to just walk away from it. Oh, that's nice. We don't have that opportunity. These responses are both indicative and imperative. Things to do, things to look for. Things to look for in our lives, and if they're there, or maybe if they're not, what do we do in response to that? And that's what we go through. We go through three primary responses that Peter lays out here. We're going to prepare our minds for action. We're going to keep sober in spirit. And we're going to set our hope completely on the grace of Jesus Christ. Starting in verse 13, prepare your mind for action. This is the starting point. This is the starting point. How many times have we looked at a race? We've looked at a foot race, and we think the starting point is when the starter puts a pistol in the air and pulls the trigger. That's not the starting point. The starting point was weeks and months and years before, preparing, training, learning what the rules are. Do I have to stay in this lane? Do I have to get in that weird crouch? Can I just like start running? Can I like elbow other people as I pass them? Or the starting point prepares us. And if we do not start with our mind, we will not get anywhere. We won't get anywhere. Virtually every modern translation, the New American Standard that I'm preaching out of, slightly different New American Standard Version that Joshua preaches out of, the ESV, the NIV, the RSV, the AV, virtually every modern translation of any level of notoriety or understanding actually doesn't translate this quite right. We have to go back to the King James. Now, please don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm not telling everybody, get rid of your favorite translation and go get the King James. I'm not going down that road. But there's a point. A better translation is, rather than prepare your mind for action, a better translation is, gird up the loins of your mind and prepare to think hard. That's a turn of phrase we don't hear much anymore. The girding up your loins part, not the thinking. Well, okay, maybe there's a couple phrases we don't hear much anymore. What does it mean to gird up your loins? I think probably most of us have a basic idea, but I went and looked it up. What does it mean to actually gird up your loins? What's involved in that? Why would you do that? Okay. Well, again, the culture that Peter's talking to and speaking from is Hebrew. They wore long flowing robes, multiple layers of them. That's how they stayed cool when it was hot. That's how they stayed warm when it was cold. That's not very practical to work in or to run in, or if you're a soldier, to fight in. I don't know about you guys, but it wouldn't take me very long of just looking to figure out that, you know, if you're going to go split wood, robes are not real good for that. I don't even have to try that one. Okay, let's just not picture that in your mind. So what do you do if that's what you wear? Well, you reach down and you grab your robes and you pull them up and you gather them up and you pull them forward so they're tight against your backside. And then you come around between your legs, grab all that loose fabric, pull it up and tie it. And in effect, it winds up looking kind of like a giant cloth diaper. But the reason for that is you're now unencumbered. You can move. You can swing an axe. You can swing a pick. You can pick up heavy weights. You don't reach down, go to pick up a big rock or something, step on the corner of your robe. When you go to go up, you just pick it up and off you go. You gird up your loins when you're going to work hard. And that's what Peter's talking about. Prepare to think hard. Girding up your loins is not a dainty process. Neither is girding up the loins of your mind, preparing to think hard. But why is this important? Well, the culture that Peter was coming from and writing to, in many ways, is very similar to our culture today. Thomas Cahill is a writer who wrote about the Dark Ages, and he said something that could easily apply to our time. He wrote, "The intellectual disciplines of distinction, definition, and systematic reasoning that had once been the glory of men like Augustine were unobtainable by readers in the Dark Ages. Their understanding of the world was simple and immediate. It was framed by myth and magic. A man no longer subordinated one thought to another with mathematical precision. Instead, he understood and looked for similarities and balances, types and paradigms, parallels and symbols. It was a world not of thoughts, but of images. And so it is in our day today as well. We think with our eyes, and as a result, our minds are never made ready for running, let alone the race called the Christian life." In the mid-1980s, a man named Neil Postman wrote a book called Amusing Ourselves to Death. This was at the time of the rise of the video cassette tape. Television, cable TV had penetrated vast swaths of the market in America, which in and of itself is not a bad thing, But more and more people were interacting with their world. They were interacting with beliefs visually rather than verbally or through words. Neil Postman wrote in the mid-1980s that the average news story was 45 seconds long. Doesn't matter how complex the issue is, it's 45 seconds long. The average attention span was 14 seconds. Today, the average news story is 15 seconds long. And the average adult's attention span is 6 seconds. And if you doubt that, next time you're out in town, watch how often people do this. 6 seconds. 6 seconds. 6 seconds. Do we approach our faith the same way? Do we interact with God in 6 second chunks or 15 second chunks? Keep sober in spirit. The word spirit there is equally translated as mind. Keep sober in mind. This speaks of, generally, the seat of reflective consciousness, the facilities of, or the faculties of perception and understanding, and those of feeling, judging, and determining. It's a fully orbed view of the mind, okay? This also denotes watchfulness, keeping our eyes open, keeping our mind sharp, and our guard up. Failing to do that is tragic. When I first was meeting with Pastor Joshua, before we had even started coming here, I looked up some of the sermons that he had preached, because I'd never heard him preach. And he preached through a series on the seven letters to the seven churches at the beginning of Revelation. One of those churches was the church at Sardis. It's one of the shortest letters that was given to that church. What was the deal with the church of Sardis? They were dead. They were dead. We don't know why. We don't know what snuck in and robbed them of their joy, diverted them from their first love, caused them to follow false teaching, bad theology. We don't know. But we do know a few things about Sardis, the city. Sardis was considered militarily impenetrable. You couldn't defeat it. Nobody messed with Sardis. You wanted to go fight a war in that area, you didn't even bring up attacking Sardis. This just wasn't going to happen. You were not going to win. And yet, two times, Sardis was overrun, sacked, and burned, destroyed to the foundations. Why? It was militarily impenetrable. Because both times, the watchmen on the walls and towers of the city were either asleep or not at their post, and the enemy overran them. That happens to us. It can happen to us. Watchfulness, girding up the loins of our mind to think about things, to think about our faith, to think about the world around us, what we believe. Being sober in spirit. These are important things. And this is not just, again, this is not just a one-off thing by some hot-headed fisherman had a good idea. This appears in gobs of scripture. Ephesians chapter 6, 13 through 17. 1 Thessalonians 5, 4 through 8. We're going to see it again in Peter a couple of times. He's going to bookend his entire letter with this concept. Being sober, being watchful. Romans 12:3, 2 Corinthians 10:4-5. It's all in there. This is supposed to be part of our life. Set your hope completely, set your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you, the revelation of Jesus Christ. This might be the toughest part. This might be the toughest part, to set our hope completely on our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That can be tough. That can be double tough. Because it's so easy. Maybe it's just a guy thing. Maybe it's just a me thing. It's okay, God, I got this. I can handle this temptation. I can figure out what I need to do here. I know how that's supposed to work. I have to think sometimes my Heavenly Father's just looking at me. Do not be conformed. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance. Remember, this is a mixed ethnicities and cultures. So there's Jewish people there, but there's also a lot of pagan converts. Rome, the Roman Empire, was at that crest where it didn't realize it yet, but the seeds of its destruction had been sown. The culture was becoming corrupt. Virtually everything that we see in the corruption of the Roman Empire, we see in the news today. We see it in the culture around us. How we approach, we as a culture, approach sexuality, how we approach identity, how we approach thinking, how we approach entertainment. It would be crazy to look at the culture around us here in Oregon, little backwater state, and not look around and see all the instances of bread and circus, just like in the Roman Empire. Keep the people amused. Keep them amused. They will not stop. They will not think. They will not question. In this, do not be conformed. These things were yours, but are not now. Repentance is the key and the call. We're to be conformed to something else. We're not supposed to look like our culture around us. The church is not supposed to reflect the culture around us. The culture should be impacted by the church. The people around our church, the people around this building, the people around every home reflected in this room should be affected by every home represented in this room. That's how it's supposed to be. But he mentions in your ignorance. What is that ignorance? Well, that is the ignorance of God. The ignorance of his mercy, his grace, the fullness of what is offered in salvation. That's how we impact the world around us. Is everybody going to respond to that? No, they're not. Maybe most may not. We don't know. None of us know the future. I mean, let's be realistic. Left to our own devices, if any of us knew the future, we'd go buy a lottery ticket and that'd be the last time any of us ever saw him. It's just, you know, we'd all be in the Bahamas. But that's not how it works. We don't know. So we share the gospel with everyone. With everyone. We seek to impact every person around us. Because we have been taken from our ignorance. And we want to see them taken from theirs. This is where the heavy lifting of thinking comes in. This is where we have to gird up the loins of our mind. God calls us to an active faith. Not a passive faith. Not a one-time. Not a box that's checked off. Not a pre-written prayer that was said. Not an experience that happened at an altar at a church. Those aren't necessarily bad things, but that's not what we're called to. We're called to be holy. Be holy even as I am holy. What is holiness? Otherness, separation, difference. It's the foundational aspect of God. And again, our biblical theology, if we spin all the way back to the book of Leviticus, be holy, even as I am holy. As God is founding the nation of his people, as he's calling a people unto himself, what is he saying over and over and over? Be holy, even as I am holy. I want you guys with me. Be holy so that we can be together. We see that in Leviticus 11. We see it in Leviticus 19, Leviticus 20. It goes on and on and on. And what is this holiness that is spoken of in the Old Testament? The holiness that's spoken of in the Gospels. The holiness, you know, on the Sermon on the Mount. On the Mount, the holiness that's spoken of here. It's separation from sin. Separation from sin. It's a life of righteousness. What is that? How does that work? That's ongoing sanctification. That's opening up our hearts, our minds, our intents, our motives, our understandings to be examined in the light of Scripture and brought, as Paul says in Corinthians, brought every thought being brought captive to Christ. How do we achieve this? How do we look at this incredible imperative block here in these three verses where Peter's just laying it out? Again, you know, Peter's not, Peter, I think it's pretty safe to say Peter was not the quiet apostle. He was not the quiet disciple. He was the here it is disciple. We go back to the beginning. Back to verse 2. The sanctifying work of the Spirit to obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood. We seek and we listen to the Holy Spirit, that glorious gift from the Father that Jesus left so that we can have the Helper, the Paraclete. We seek and listen to the Holy Spirit who will help us obey Jesus Christ, obey the calls on our lives and hearts and the commands on our lives that he has for us. We return to the foot of the cross to be sprinkled by the blood. We return to the foot of the cross to be sprinkled in the blood. Literally, wash, rinse, repeat. Wash, rinse, repeat. Wash our sin away. Rinse us clean. Do it again and again and again, as often as necessary, as our Lord lovingly, lovingly does. That is how and why we live in hope and holiness. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the clarity of Scripture, for the truth of Scripture, for the impactful weight that it has. It addresses every aspect of our life. Father God, I ask that through the power of your Holy Spirit, we would seek to have every aspect of our life taken captive to your Son, Jesus Christ. Every thought, every word, every aspiration, every desire, every action, every intent. That we would gird up the loins of our minds to think long and hard, to put in the work to bring our lives in line with your will. May we have the strength to do so, and we trust and we pray, Lord, that as we take these feeble steps, as these little children, these little toddlers, as we learn to walk, that you would strengthen our legs, as you strengthen our minds, that we would walk ever closer with you. In your name.